let's begin with some prayers. Om Ajnanati Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashchatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpataru Bhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Eva Cha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srinivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So I would like to share my screen. Can you please give me that right? And I also like to record if possible. Hare Krishna, Madhavanand Prabhu. It's an honor to see you here. Please feel free to add any comments whenever you like. In fact, you should be speaking. I should be hearing. Okay. So, this is a very important topic we're discussing today of interfaith. I hope you can see my screen now. I'll be using my screen as a whiteboard, basically. So I will type some things also over here as we move forward. So our topic is how to see other faiths maturely. And here I'll start with a quote by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, which demonstrates how to see other faiths maturely. And so I've highlighted what he's saying through this quote. So this is from the Chaitanya Shikshamrita. When we have occasion to be present at the place of worship of other religiousness at the time of their worship, we should stay there in a respectful mood, contemplating thus. Here is being worshipped my adorable highest entity in a different form than that of mine. So there's some things important over here. There's diversity. They are worshipping in a form different from mine. Bhaktivinoda Thakur is acknowledging that. And there is a respectful acknowledgement of diversity. And this quote continues in the next slide. Then he says, due to a different practice of a different kind, I cannot thoroughly comprehend the system of theirs. But seeing it, I am feeling a greater attachment for my own system. God is one. I bow down before his emblem, as I see here, and offer my prayer to my Lord, who has adopted this different emblem, so that he may increase my love toward him in the form that is acceptable for me. So in this quote, we will see these two themes. Humility toward other traditions. Bhaktivinoda Thakur is an acharya. He is, in our tradition's understanding, he's an eternal liberated soul which has descended to this world. But he is saying, I cannot thoroughly comprehend the system of theirs. Because it's a different practice of a different kind. So there is humility. We cannot just summarily judge this is bad and this is good. Humility toward other traditions. And simultaneously, what he's saying? Fidelity. Fidelity means faithfulness. He's saying by seeing how God is so merciful that he has manifested in a different way over here to these people, I am appreciating the mercifulness of God. And therefore, my devotion to him is increasing in the form that is acceptable for me. So we will try to discuss how we can philosophically understand and practically understand and apply these three values in our life. Respectful acknowledgement of diversity, humility toward other traditions, and fidelity toward our own tradition. So let's look at this now. So why is interfaith needed at all? When you talk about interfaith, why do we need to have deal with other traditions? Then what are the challenges in interfaith? And how can we, as followers of the Bhagavad Gita, as followers of the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, how can we engage in interfaith properly? So let's begin. So why is it needed? Because we are living in an increasingly interconnected world. And this interconnectedness is happening in many ways. First of all, we have global interconnectedness through trade, tourism, immigration, and now especially the internet, which acts with the traditional media and social media. So what happens because of this? Because of this, we interact with a large number of people at different times in different places. So we will have to interact with people of other faiths. And we can't live in insular bubbles. Insular bubbles means that I will live with people who share my faith. I'll not associate with anyone else. Well, it's not practically possible. Our neighbors may be different. Our colleagues may be different. Our co-students may be different. So we can't just deal with only people who share our faith. Or sometimes our interaction may only be preaching. That means I'm interacting with others, but only on terms that I want them to join my faith. That may not happen for many people. So we do interact with people who are not sharing our faith, but usually our interaction is for preaching to them. But what about people who are already committed to their tradition? They have no intention of changing their particular faith. How will we interact with them? We need to coexist with them, and we need to connect with them. And we need to connect individually, socially, nationally. Otherwise, there can be so many conflicts. And we may ourselves end up becoming a part of the conflict. So this is the brief first part. Why is it needed? Because we live in an interconnected world. So we need interfaith. Now, what are the challenges in interfaith? One of the biggest challenges is that every tradition claims to be the best, if not to have the fullest and final revelation of ultimate reality. And then what is the problem with every tradition claiming this way? Because there can be disagreement, there can be conflict. And not just practical conflict in terms of different traditions disagreeing, but even conceptually, intellectually, how do we make sense of it? If there's one ultimate reality, then why are various traditions so different? So, now, there can be many other challenges of interfaith, but from our brief perspective that we are taking today, two problems. Practically, now, if everyone claims to be the ultimate reality, giving the ultimate reality, then who is actually giving the ultimate reality? And if there's only one ultimate reality, from practical, how do I make sense intellectually of the different traditions? So now, broadly speaking, when one tradition interacts with another tradition, one religion interacts with another religion, their attitudes can range over three broad dimensions. They're incorrect. And this is, say, for example, some religious traditions say that other religions are not, leave alone ways to God, they are representations or they're creations of Satan. They're creations of the devil to deviate people away from God. So they are completely incorrect. Another attitude might be that the other traditions, maybe they were useful at that particular time. And the third attitude is that, yeah, they contain some truth, but we contain the fullest truth. So the other tradition is incorrect, irrelevant, or incomplete. Now, again, this whole presentation that I'm doing is quite a simplified presentation because it's a complicated subject. But we are trying to get, a map of the territory before we explore the territory. So the challenges are, how do we see other traditions maturely when there are significant differences? So then we look at, how can a Gita follower do this? So for understanding this, broadly speaking, we can say that there are three. One is exclusivism. And we can say, broadly speaking, many of the Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, in their mainstream versions are exclusivist. None shall go back to the Father except through me, Jesus is attributed to have said. So like that Muhammad is attributed, said that he is the seal of all prophets. So that's exclusivism. So the Abrahamic religions are like that. Sorry, this is. This is pluralism. So some people say that actually we are all having different faiths. Let everybody live cohesively, tolerantly. So pluralism. That means all paths are right. Now I have positioned both of them as extremes of a pendulum. Why? Because exclusivism sounds wrong. If God is unlimited, why should the path to him be limited to only one particular path? Why should one particular religion have exclusive rights to God? That seems narrow-minded. So this can very easily lead to intolerance, wherein some people may say that our path is the only right path, your path is wrong. If you don't follow our path, you are going to go to hell. And some more extremist versions may say that not only are you going to go to hell, we will help you get there faster. So that can lead to brutal violence. So now this is exclusivism strikes us as wrong. Now, broadly speaking, in today's mainstream world, people recommend pluralism. So India is said to be a pluralist, religiously pluralist society. While pluralism sounds good, you know, okay, you follow your path, I follow my path. So in terms of people having the right to follow their own path, that is fine. We can be pluralist. But in terms of conceptual understanding, pluralism doesn't work. Why not? Because if all paths are right, then one among all paths, if all paths are right, then one among all paths is this path also. Isn't it? If I conclude a complete set of all paths, if all paths are right, then one among those all paths is the one path which says only my path is right. So if we are really going to be pluralistic, if all paths are right, then even this path should be right. But if this path is right, if only my path is right, is correct, then this can't be correct. So pluralism is logically incoherent. It doesn't function. And somebody may say, my path is atheism. Is that also right? Well, you can say that you have the free will to be atheistic. But in terms of ultimate reality, if we say atheism is also right, then all religious traditions become wrong. So we can't have seem open-minded. It may seem tolerant. Now, in terms of socio-cultural functioning, society may be pluralist. But in terms of intellectual understanding, if you're pluralist, you say we are being open-minded. No, it's good to be open-minded, but we can't be so open-minded that our brains fall out. We can't be so open-minded that our brains fall out. So this is logically incoherent. Now the Bhagavad Gita's understanding is inclusivism. Krishna says in Gita 4.11, Mama Vartamanu Vartante Manushyah Patha Sarvashah, that all people are on my path. So what he's trying to say is there's one common purpose, and for that purpose, there are many paths. So that purpose includes many paths. Let's try to understand this further diagrammatically. So if we consider a metaphor of trekking, going up a mountain. So the bottom of the mountain is material consciousness. The top of the mountain is spiritual consciousness. And various traditions, they are in one sense on a calmer journey. They're all trying to elevate people's consciousness from material consciousness to spiritual consciousness, from materialism towards love of the ultimate reality, devotion to the ultimate reality. So this is, we could use this mountain metaphor. Now, if we understand that all souls are entangled in material existence, that's from our philosophical perspective. Others may have a different perspective, but we also still understand that there is material consciousness, spiritual consciousness, and Prabhupada writes how all the religious teachers, prophets, they have been said within this framework of the metaphor, sorry, of this mountain metaphor. Let's move forward. So exclusivism, what does it mean? That I am going up by this path, and this is the only path up the mountain. So my way or the highway, as they say. Now, what is wrong with exclusivism? They are attached more to path than to purpose. This is the only path. Now, the purpose is to go up the mountain. There might be other ways of going up the mountain also. So if you are attached more to path than to purpose, then that makes us exclusivist. Why should there be only one way up the mountain? But if you go to the other way, to pluralism, pluralism means all paths are right. But the problem is all paths don't take us up the mountain. Some paths may take us a little up and back down. Some paths may just take a little up and keep us going around. Some people paths may end 3/4 up the mountain. Some paths may end halfway up the mountain. So, and we could have even some paths go round and round the mountain. Some paths go away from the mountain into a valley also. So pluralism doesn't work from a logical perspective. So the inclusivist understanding is that there are different paths up the mountain. There's one path here, there's one path here, there's one path here. So there are different paths which all are meant to take a person to the top of the mountain. So inclusivism involves one purpose, same purpose. So same purpose means everybody wants to go to the top of the mountain. And the idea is that we are attached more to purpose than to path. More to purpose than to path. That means, okay, we are all going to the top of the mountain. Now, based on this understanding of the purpose, we see Prabhupada, when he interacted with Christians and they asked Swamiji, what are your thoughts about Jesus? Prabhupada said, he's our guru. He had so much love for God that he was ready to sacrifice his life. Anybody who has that much love for God is our guru. So Prabhupada is saying, oh, you know, he came from a particular different tradition. He gave a slightly different conception of God. That may be true, but Prabhupada is focusing on the same purpose. So inclusivism means we understand that there may be different paths, but that doesn't mean all paths are right. We have to have some objective criteria. Is that path raising one towards spiritual consciousness? Now, how do we define spiritual consciousness? It doesn't have to necessarily mean Krishna consciousness. It can broadly mean one is seeking that which is beyond the temporary. One is seeking that which is lasting. One is developing attraction and attachment to the eternal. So that is the understanding of spiritual consciousness. So there can, and if a person is going up a particular path, we respect them to go along that path. And Prabhupada's attitude towards people was, say, if somebody was a nominal follower of a particular religion, then I'll come to nominal followers a little later. If somebody is a committed follower of a particular religion, say somebody was a Christian pastor or a Christian priest, then Prabhupada's main focus in interacting with them was not to convert them to Krishna consciousness, but to encourage them to follow the Bible better. You talk about the commandment, especially about meat eating. And you would say that, follow that. So the idea is that rise to spiritual consciousness. If we are killing animals, then we are not rising to a spiritual consciousness. So Prabhupada acknowledged the validity of other paths. And encourage, if somebody is committed to that path, Prabhupada encouraged them to follow that path. So now, does this mean, okay, if this is a path up the mountain, this is a path up the mountain, there may be another path over here. Are all paths that go up the mountain the same? Then that means if we understand that various different religions, at least the major religions, have come from God, then are all of them the same? Not exactly. So we can have something called inclusive supremacy. Inclusive supremacy means what? That we accept that there are various paths and various paths can take us to the ultimate reality. But if we are following a particular path, there is something special about our tradition, our path. That's why we are following it. So what is special about our path? So if we go back to the mountain metaphor, if you go back to the mountain metaphor, you know, some paths might be more slippery. Some paths might be more rocky. Some paths might be well constructed and easier to go up. Some paths may have nice scenery all around. Some paths may be so clear that we can have a very nice vision of what is there at the peak. So just because all paths are equal. So that means that if we are following a particular path, we have not only the full right, but also the responsibility to talk about what is special about our path. Just being we are tolerant doesn't mean that we accept that we are broad-minded, doesn't necessarily mean that we say simplistically that all paths are equal. Now we can talk about many things about the speciality of our tradition. And in this way, other followers of other traditions may also talk about what is special about their tradition. Now, how much of it is objective, how much of it is subjective, that may be a matter of debate. But broadly, I'm talking about this in terms of three things. In our tradition, you can call this as overall as Sambandha, Abhideya, and Prayojan. But what is it? We have clarity of our condition. You know, in the various traditions about the world, across the world, because they don't accept the principles of karma and reincarnation. So why are we suffering? Now, why has a good God created such a discriminatory world where some child is born in poverty and some child is born in wealth? So we are souls bound by karma across various lives. So this gives a clear understanding of our condition. Now, each of these, I'm not going to elaborate. I'm just giving a pointers over here. So having respect for other tradition doesn't mean that, you remember I talked about fidelity for our tradition. Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying that my faith, my devotion to the Lord in the form that is acceptable to me is increasing. So clarity of our condition, where are we and why are we here? Then the beauty of the destination. So we are going to see the mountain peak very clearly and we see how beautiful it is. That inspires us to go up. So for us, the destination is very vividly revealed, that the extent of the revelation of divinity, God as a person, not just as a person, but all attractive person who performs endearingly sweet pastimes. That conception of Krishna as God is an extraordinarily beautiful and sweet conception. So that is one more special facility, or you could say special feature or facility that our tradition offers. So if you want to go up the mountain, to understand why I'm at the bottom right now, you understand that how beautiful the top of the mountain is. That inspires us to go. And then we have the accessibility of the process. That there are different traditions which may talk about the processes to different degrees. But by the mercy of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we have the holy name of Krishna. So currently we are celebrating the Holy Name Week, and this is a talk about that part. So this is a very, very accessible process for us. So now there are many holy names of God, but we have been given a specially potent holy name of God, the Yuga Dharma, the Mahamantra. So accessibility of the process. This is a very accessible, relishable, universal process. So in these terms, we can always talk about the speciality of our tradition. And now, before we talk about it, we understand it, we appreciate it. So our attitude is not that other paths are wrong, or that it is not that other paths, people following other paths are condemned, but rather there is something special about our tradition, and that is what we can share. Now that brings us to the next point of another aspect of our philosophy is achintya bheda bhed. So there is oneness and difference, and we need to know when to focus on the difference and when to focus on the oneness. So when we are talking with each other, when we are talking with people who are already committed to our tradition, then what do? We focus on the Bheda aspect. How is this different? How is this special? And that inspires us to commit to our own tradition. See, all traditions are the same, then okay, why should I follow in one particular path? So I was earlier talking about Prabhupada's attitude. Those who are committed Christians, he encouraged them to follow Christianity better. But those who were nominal Christians, Prabhupada encouraged them to practice bhakti as given by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Prabhupada was not converting them. So they were, we could say from the metaphor point of view, they were just at the bottom of the mountain and they were connected with the path, but they were not going up by that path. So, okay, you are at the bottom of the mountain, come here and take this path. This is an easy path. This is an attractive path. Take it up. So in that sense, Prabhupada was not converting people in the material sense. Prabhupada was elevating people. So, unfortunately, when some people convert, what they are doing is, rather than going up let's go back to this metaphor. Say, yeah. Say, rather than going up by their own path, what they are doing is they are going round and round at the bottom of the mountain and pulling people down from whatever path they are going up by. So that is completely a waste of one's time and a waste of others. When we talk about Bheda, we talk about the difference. We don't have to deny the differences. We talk about them so that, okay, this is special about my path. Therefore, I will take this and I'll rise up. So we talk about the Bheda to commit the speciality of our path, to commit ourselves to our path more. And when we are going to talk, when we are going to interact with others, at that time, we may focus on Abheda. No, we don't have to, if somebody is already committed to some other path, at that time, we don't have to go about telling them, oh, my path is superior, my path is superior. If somebody is already committed to a particular path, look at the common values. Look at what brings us together. And then we appreciate other traditions and they appreciate our tradition. So when we have interfaith conferences or interfaith meetings, we will talk about the role of the holy name. May somebody from Christian tradition, Islamic tradition, they may talk about the holy name, and we may talk about the power of sound. And then even the Buddhist tradition, they have the idea of sound being very powerful in spiritual elevation. So we focus on commonalities, and then we can appreciate other traditions also. So that way, we see the Abheda. They're also on the same journey. They're also growing. When Prabhupada was in Iran, at that time, while he was talking with some disciples, he suddenly in the background, there's a mosque nearby, and from the background, the namaz prayer started. And Prabhupada closed his eyes, put his hands together, and he heard out the full namaz prayers. And then when he opened his eyes were bright. He said, wasn't that beautiful? And then one devotee asked over there, Prabhupada, wouldn't it be better if they were chanting Hare Krishna instead? And Prabhupada looked almost hurt. He said, why are you making me sectarian? No, we are worshipping God by our way, and they are worshipping God by their way. So in this case, it's already a mosque. It's a place where God is going to be worshipped. We are not going to expect people who are running a mosque to get converted, to change their faith. We don't want to use the word conversion. So at that time, appreciate what they are doing. So focus on Abheda, to inspire appreciation of other traditions. So they are worshipping God in their way. We are worshipping God in our way. Sometimes when I'm traveling abroad, you know, if you're traveling, sometimes I forget to do Gayatri on time. But when I might say, they take out a mat and they sit down there in namaz. So when I see how punctually they are doing the namaz, I think, you know, I'm not that punctual in doing my Gayatri. So what Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying is, seeing others doing their faith properly can inspire us. We don't have to become insecure that they are doing this. Oh. Just because they are following a particular path which is different from mine doesn't make my path wrong. And I don't have to prove that their path is wrong to be secure in my path. So we should know when to focus on Bheda, when to focus on Abheda. And overall, the balance is we have to balance Bheda and Abheda to have a real relationship. Real relationship doesn't mean simplistically saying, oh, all paths teach the same, all religions teach the same thing. Well, not really, not exactly. We can say there are some essential truths that are quite similar, but there are many significant differences. So we balance the Bheda and Abheda. So just to have a good relationship, we don't have to dissolve our differences. Just like two people can be friends, even when they have differences of opinion. Two people can disagree about two things, and still they can be good friends. So we can have a healthy balance of Bheda and Abheda. And based on that, we can be friends with people who are of other traditions. So we talked till now about how the follower of a Gita can see people from other traditions, can appreciate them. In here, till now, what we talked about is broadly the tradition itself. How do we see that in a harmonious way, in a spiritually informed way. Now let's move on from looking at the tradition to interacting with specific people. That will be the last part of our talk. So we need a philosophical perspective that people's behavior is, we need to understand that it's not determined solely by their religious identity, but it is determined primarily by their individual mentality, by their individual mentality. And that individual mentality is shaped by the three modes. So the modes are like a non-sectarian criteria. I have a Muslim friend and he told me something very striking. He said that I can communicate better with moderates of other traditions than extremists of my own tradition. I can communicate better. So the moderation is a characteristic of Sattvaguna. So a person Sattvaguna in a Muslim tradition and a person of Sattvaguna in a Vaishnava tradition, they can communicate better with each other than say a Muslim from a Muslim from Sattvaguna and a Muslim in Tamaguna. And same we can apply to a Vaishnava who is overall having a Sattvic mentality and a Vaishnava who is having a Tamasic mentality. You know, we can all think of, even in our own tradition, there are some people we just don't get along with. Now, we don't want to say that they are in Tamoguna, but some of them may be. Of course, sometimes it may be we are in Tamoguna. We don't know. But the point is that differences don't come just because there can be differences. So the point is that the philosophical perspective is we don't see people based on their religious designation. We see them based on the modes. And this is what Krishna actually says in the Bhagavad Gita. In the 17th chapter, Arjuna asks the question, those who don't follow Shastra, that means he's referring to the Shastra given in the Vedic tradition. Yaha Shastra vidhim utsrujya vartate shraddhayanvitah tesham nishthatuka Krishna sattvamaho rajastamaha. That they have some Shraddha, but they're not following Shastra. Then what is their level? And Krishna says, it depends on the modes. And then he talks about various ways in which we can understand the mode a person is in. So this framework of the modes is actually a very universal framework. So how the modes shape our interaction? When a person is in goodness, then there can be discussion, and discussion will lead to mutual understanding. It doesn't necessarily mean mutual agreement because we have differences, but the mutual understanding will come up. That is the nature of the mode of goodness. When there is a mode of passion, then what will happen is there's a tendency to dominate. I will prove myself right. And I'll either prove myself right by intellectual superiority. If I engage in a discussion, it is simply to prove that you are wrong. So intellectual superiority or sometimes even political superiority. That means that I want to overpower you. I want to make you my slave. Under my thumb. And if you go to the mode of ignorance, it is not just domination, it will be destruction of other traditions. You know that you don't even have a right to exist. Destruction of others for one's own exclusive rule. Now, many people they associate Islam with extremism. And there is some truth to that, that there have been a lot of extremist violence associated with Islam. But if you look at the Christian tradition, there has been extremism associated with Christianity also, when they tried to colonize the world and what all they did. But the point is that if you look at Islamic extremism, the biggest victims of Islamic extremism have been Muslims. So when a particular extremist faction, they disagree not only with other religions, but they disagree violently with others of their own broader religious group also. And the same can apply to other religious traditions also. Catholics and Protestants had a violent 100-year war. And we see sometimes even our own tradition, what to speak of going to other religious traditions, even two devotees from two different temples can argue vehemently. Two devotees from two different, having two different spiritual masters can argue terribly. So what to speak of that? You know, even if there's complete commonality, sometimes people say, if there was only one religion in the world, there are no differences like this, then we would live happily. Well, no. If tomorrow we woke up with, say, no religious differences, no nationalistic differences, no racial differences. We all belong to the same race, same country, same religion. By tomorrow afternoon, we would find some reasons, some differences to fight over. Because the fights are not because of the differences. The fights are due to our attitude toward the differences. And those attitudes are determined by our moods. So when a person is in the mode of passion or ignorance, they will find some reason or the other to fight. So the modes, as I said, they offer a non-sectarian perspective. Now, every religion has people in goodness, passion, and ignorance. And their individual mode determines the way they practice, present, and propagate their religion. Now, it is possible that in a particular religious tradition, their leaders might be more in the modes of passion and ignorance. Then the prominent presentation of that religious tradition would be more in passion and ignorance. Or their overall approach toward other religious traditions may be in the mode of passion and ignorance. But it's not so much just the content of the religious traditions as the practitioners of the tradition that will determine so how people function. That's why we need to see not just this religion or that religion. These people are like this, those people like that. We need to have a broader perspective based on the modes. Otherwise, we are not seeing through Shastra Chakshu. We are not seeing through the eyes of scripture. We are seeing simply through the eyes of our own prejudices, our own biases. So I'll conclude with one last slide. Now, a balanced perspective. So if we want one extreme perspective, we reduce people to their group identity. Where you say that, oh, all people of this religion are intolerant. All people of this religion are violent. Or the other extreme would be reduce people to their individuality, divorced from their group identity. That people's behavior is not affected by the group they belong to at all. That's also not true. You know, if you're going to speak with a person who's from Mexico and you're going to speak with them in Hindi, and we start talking about Krishna and Radha, that's not going to work. We're not going to communicate also. So people's group identity affects who they are, but they're primarily affected by who they are as individuals. So when we interact with people, focus on people as individuals while being aware of their group identity. Okay, this person is a Buddhist, this person is a Shaivite, this person is a Muslim, this person is an atheist. But just because of their particular group identity, that doesn't mean that that alone shapes the way we behave with them. We approach people as individuals. As individuals, some people might be atheists, but they might be in the mode of goodness in terms of their functioning, in terms of their interaction with others, in terms of their overall habits. And some person might claim to be a very devout religious follower, but they might be in the mode of ignorance. So we need to focus on people as individuals. That's how we can have healthy relationships, whether it is with people of our faith or people of different faiths. So I'll summarize. I discussed broadly today three main points. I started with talking about the quote of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, based on which we discussed the desirable values that we want to have are respectful acknowledgement of diversity, and then humility toward other traditions. Don't just judge and condemn them, but humility toward other. I don't understand it fully. And fidelity, faithfulness toward our own tradition. And then we discussed three parts. Why is interfaith needed? Because we live in a multicultural world because of the interconnectedness through technology and other things. What is the challenge? Every religion may consider that its own, it offers the full and final revelation. So what do we do? So how do we deal with that? For that, I talked about, from our tradition, three perspectives. First is that our tradition doesn't talk about either exclusivism, my path is the only path, or pluralism, all paths are right. It is inclusivism. There is one purpose from the bottom of the mountain, top of the mountain, and there can be many paths up the mountain. Now, while we agree to inclusivism, there is also something called inclusivist supremacy. That means our path has some special facilities. So I talked about the clarity of our condition, the beauty of the revelation of divinity, and the accessibility of the process centered on the holy name. So we can share. the specialities of our path. So depending on the context, we focus on abhed. When we want, we focus on the abhed to inspire commitment to our own path. And when to inspire appreciation for other paths, we focus on the bhed aspect. And then I talked about, that's the broadly how we appreciate other traditions. Then while dealing with individuals, rather than reducing them to their group identity, we see them as individuals. That every tradition has people in the three modes, and people in goodness across traditions can interact with each other. And people within the same tradition, if they're in goodness and ignorance, they will not be able to interact. So we acknowledge, we are aware of people's group identity, but we focus on them as individuals and relate with them as individuals. That's how, even if we have differences, we don't have to agree over everything to be friends with each other. And that's how, that's a mature approach to interfaith. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. Thank you very much for explaining it in such a metamorphical mountain way, where, you know, going from the material consciousness to spiritual consciousness, and explaining those parts of exclusivity, inclusivity, and pluralism. And of course, at the end, telling us how exactly to apply the Achintya Abhedabhed principle. So thank you very much, Prabhuji. I personally have a lot of questions to ask to you, because like I mentioned, that I'm staying here in the Western world, and I have my friends who are Muslims, and I have my friends who are Christians, and who are always preaching to me. But you know, being a gentle host, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give the opportunity to the others to ask their questions first. So I have a question by Madhavi Gauri Devi Mataji, and she asked this question, that Bhagavad Gita says about Sanatan Dharma, that wherein rendering of service is the exact aim of one's life. Is the top of the mountain in all different faiths refer to the Sanatan Dharma?
Not exactly. That when we talk about the top of the mountain, there is some understanding of the fact that we are meant to serve God. We are meant to love God, and that love is based on service. So now, exactly the understanding of the soul having a eternal nature of service, that specific things might not be there. As the clarity of our identity is not so much there. So the idea of service is there, no doubt, but specifically service as an innate feature of the soul, that's not there. Now, St. Augustine says that, oh, Father, you have made us for thee, and our hearts will find no rest till they rest in thee. So the idea is that we'll be restless, we'll be internally homeless till we find rest in God. Now, how is that rest? That is in the mood of a loving service. So we could say that the specific term is definitely not used. And the idea of a soul having an eternal feature of service, that specifically may not be there. But broad understanding that we are meant to develop a loving relationship centered on loving service to God, that is there in other traditions.
All right. Thank you so much for your question. Thank you so much for your answer, Prabhuji. There's another question that we have, and that is from Shyam Sakha Prabhu. He's asking, on an individual basis, how do we interact, assuming we cannot just ignore them, with the persons of exclusivist or a pluralist learning?
I don't understand the question. Can you repeat it, please?
Okay.
Last part.
So the question is that on an individual basis, how do we interact with the persons of exclusivist or pluralist learnings, and assuming we cannot ignore them?
Okay. See, for most people, their religious tradition doesn't really make a big difference to them in terms of how we interact. In today's world, most people just want to get on with their life. And unless we try to impose our faith on them, they are not going to impose their faith on us. It's more or less like exclusivist idea or the pluralist idea is wrong. If they are ready to listen, we can talk with them. But if they are not, just let it be. Because they are having their own conceptions, and everybody takes their own, everybody's on their journey, and they will evolve. So in general, it's good to test the pulse and speak some points which they may find reasonable. and then develop the discussion. But if we find ourselves hitting a stone wall, then just leave it, because not everybody will be receptive, understanding. So first is try to, don't reduce people to their particular conceptions. Or this person is a fanatic. No, people may be ideologically exclusivist, but still functionally in today's world, they may be quite normal functioning people. Otherwise, they can't live. Somebody working in a professional setting, in a social setting, they go around telling everybody else their religion is wrong. They won't be able to survive. So most people don't do that. So basically, have a functional relationship, and based on the reciprocity, move further. Okay.
Oh, wait. Thank you, Prabhuji. On a similar line, I have a personal question to ask here, and I take this platform an opportunity to ask you that. You know, when we hear devotees, we have also heard as a principle that Jare Dekho Tahe Kaho Krishna Updesh. So we want to talk about Krishna to whomsoever we meet. But sometimes we meet, like, you know, I'm staying in Canada and I met one devotee, not a devotee, I would say, a person who's just my neighbor. He is a very hardcore preacher for Christianity. He keeps inviting me to church. He keeps inviting me for his programs. And if I say something to him, I know he gives a close ear. So how should I be dealing with him in that scenario?
See, as I said, that if somebody is committed to a particular path, mm-hmm. then there is, and if they are trying to bring us to their path, then I think we have to set boundaries in the relationship. Tell him that, you know, I respect what you are doing, but I expect similar respect from you. Mm-hmm. I'm committed to a particular path. If you want to discuss some things, we can discuss together. But I'm not really, I'm interested. I have my own path and I'm happy with it. So if somebody wants to have a discussion, then we can always have a discussion. And, you know, we have devotees who have written books on Krishna consciousness and Christianity. There are quite, Satyaraj Prabhu, Stephen Rosen has written a couple of books. And then there are a couple of other devotees also who have written books, which can be the basis of discussions. But overall, if somebody is already committed to a particular path, then just connect with them on other things and have a relationship. If occasionally they invite us to their place and we invite them to our place. If, you know, sometime at one time I was invited to a church on the occasion of Christmas, and they asked me to speak. Now I'm not going to speak about Krishna over there. I appreciate the spirit of Christian, of Christmas and the sacrifice of Jesus. And they appreciated that. So we have to see according to Deshkala Patra. So the idea is, our purpose is, we want to elevate our consciousness. We want to go up the mountain and we want to help others go up the mountain. So if somebody wants to come by our path, great. If somebody is on some other path, let them go by their path. So our purpose should not be to damage their faith, nor is it to let our faith be damaged. Okay.